Hello everybody and welcome to this video in which I want to explain you a few basics on distributions and Fourier transform. I should say that I will be quite brief, but you find more details in nice textbooks. A few suggestions are on our website. Just to give you an outline, I will first of all introduce the Schwarz space, then the space of tempered distributions, explain how to do computations with such tempered distributions, then move on to the Fourier transform, and at the end I will make a remark on general distributions, like non-tempered distributions. Okay, before introducing the Schwarz space in Rn, I need to introduce the multi-indices. So we are in Rn, and then what is a multi-index? This is an n-tuple, so we have p1 to pn, an n-tuple of non-negative integers. Let's just write it like this, n including 0 to the power n. And then we can define the partial derivative of such a multi-index. Let's call this multi-index by alpha. So then d alpha is defined by, well, we take d by dx1 to the power p1 and so on, times d by dxn to the power pn. And similarly, we can define x to the power alpha as x1 to the power p1 and so on, times xn to the power pn. So therefore, these pi's here, they tell us about the power of the corresponding partial derivative or of the corresponding coordinate component. Okay, and I should also mention there is the absolute value of alpha. This is defined by p1 plus and so on plus pn. This is the so-called order of the multi-index. Well, and this makes sense because if you look at the order of this derivative here, so just how many derivatives come up, so then the order of this differential operator is precisely the order of the corresponding multi-index. And similarly, we have here this monomial x to the alpha, then the order of this monomial is again the order of the multi-index. Okay, so this is just a convenient notation for writing whatever higher partial derivatives or polynomials in the coordinate functions. And now we introduce the so-called Schwarz norms. Suppose we have a function little f on Rn, so then its pq norm, this is defined by, so we take all multi-indices of order at most p, and we take all multi-indices b of order at most q. Okay, and then we take x to the alpha times del beta f of x, take the absolute value, well, and then we take the supremum over x in n. Okay, of course, this doesn't need to be finite, but now they introduce the Schwarz space, so S of Rn, so this is defined by all functions where it should all be smooth so that all these derivatives here exist. So C infinity of RN, say real value, it works similarly for complex value, it doesn't really matter. Maybe I don't write here, I'm not specific here, just functions on RN which are smooth. And they have the property that these PQ norms are finite for all PQ non-negative, of course they are integers. Okay. So this is the so-called Schwarz space, named after Laurent Schwarz, who invented distributions in the 1950s, if I remember this correctly. Okay, and similarly these norms here, these are the so-called Schwarz norms. Good, what does this mean? So the Schwarz functions, of course, they are all smooth, but moreover they decay faster than polynomially, because here the statement is if we multiply any polynomial, then we get a bounded function, because the supremum should be finite. So therefore the function needs to decay faster than polynomially. And the same holds true for all the derivatives. So this means the function and all its partial derivatives decay faster than polynomially, or what one says, they have rapid decay. So thus, f and all its partial derivative have rapid decay. Okay, where rapid decay is well defined by just what we did, namely that if you multiply by any monomial, we want to get a bounded function. Good, so this is the Schwarz space. So it's a nice space of functions. In particular, all these functions can be differentiated. We can compute the Fourier transform. So all the operations we want to perform are well defined on the Schwarz space. And then our idea is to extend all these operations to the distributions by considering the corresponding dual space. And before I can explain you what the dual space is and how these operators can be extended, I first need to introduce a topology on the Schwarz space. Topology on S of Rn. And this can be done in various ways. I mean, the more sophisticated ways to work with uniform spaces, topological vector spaces. So we have a family of seminorms. Here, of course, I want to keep everything as simple as possible. And then the simplest way is to say, well, we define convergence in the Schwarz space. So we say Fn converges to F in S of Rn if the norm of f minus fn tends to zero. But now, of course, the question is like which norm? We have a whole family of norms, and what one does here, one imposes that this should hold for all p and q. And I'll explain you soon why this is the right definition or good definition. Good. So now we have the Schwarz space, it has a topology. Now we introduce S prime of Rn as, these are then the so-called tempered distributions, they are defined as, well, just the dual space. Let's just write it like this, star. Or, in other words, so these are all the linear functionals, so S of Rn, mapping to, say, real or complex. Let's just do it real valued here for simplicity. So now this should be linear and continuous. Okay, what does it mean continuous? Well, continuous with respect to the topology, which we just introduced here. And if one works this out more in detail, what this means, that, well, that T applied to F, the absolute value is bounded by a constant times a norm. Well, this is the usual, this is how continuity of a linear mapping is expressed. Now, of course, the question is like, which norm do we take here? And the statement is that for any norm, there exists P and Q such that this inequality holds, of course, and a constant, such that this inequality holds for all Schwarz functions. Okay, this is already the basic definition. Maybe before going on, let me point out the fact that it suffices to this satisfy this inequality for any P and Q. This is quite convenient. In fact, this is essential for speaking of distributions. So this means we have a rather weak condition to satisfy here. In other words, this is easy to satisfy. It just suffices, whatever, if you choose P and Q sufficiently large or anything like that, then this inequality here holds. The fact that here it suffices to satisfy this for any P and Q is a consequence of the fact that the topology here, convergence of Schwarz functions, was defined. Here we need to impose this for all P and Q. So we have like a strong condition on convergence in the Schwarz space, and as a consequence, the dual space gets very large, and this is then the space of tempered distributions. Distributions can be regarded as generalized functions. How can this be understood? Namely, suppose we take an ordinary function in, well, here we can be quite general, it doesn't need to be a Schwarz function, for example, whatever, a bounded function, bounded measurable function on Rn. Then one can introduce a corresponding distribution T sub g, and this is defined by, well, if we let this act on f, this is defined by simply integrating integral over Rn g of x times f of x dnx. Well, and since the function f here has rapid decay, this integral is in fact well defined. And let me just quickly do this. Why is this a distribution? TGF, so we have to estimate this by a suitable Schwarz norm. And well, the trick is the following. We take here, well, this of course we take first of all the absolute value of x, and then here we insert a factor 1 over 1 plus norm of x squared to the power n plus 1 over 2 times, and of course then we also have to need to multiply by this factor n plus 1 over 2. Well, and then this is multiplied by f of x, or absolute value of f of x dnx. Okay, and now we estimate this integral as follows. Well, first of all, this g of x is bounded. So this is bounded by, well, the L infinity norm of G. Moreover, what about this term here? So we know that this is also bounded by a certain constant times the Schwarz norm. Well, and if you look at how this factor here grows at infinity, so it goes like it's bounded by a polynomial of degree n plus 1. So therefore we have here n plus 1. Well, and there are no derivatives. This is why we put here 0. Okay, and then we are left with this integrand here, but this is an integrable function because it decays sufficiently fast at infinity for the integral to converge. And therefore we find where this is a smaller than a certain constant times the L infinity norm of g times a certain Schwarz norm. Well, and then going back to what it means here, continuity, so this shows that Tg is in fact continuous, so therefore it's a well-defined distribution. And in this way, every function can be regarded, or at least every bounded function. In fact, you can do it a bit more generally, but let's not go into this here. So every function can be regarded as a distribution, but the space of distributions is much larger, and this is why the distributions can be regarded as generalized functions. Good. Next, what are derivatives of distributions? And the idea is to work with, to consider this specific distributions here, which are functions. Well, and then if you take a derivative of a function, then you can just integrate by parts and bring the derivative to the test function, to the Schwarz function. And once you have done this, everything is well defined for general distribution. So this means derivatives of distributions just a motivation note that for any g, well, suppose we take here bounded smooth function c infinity intersected with L infinity of Rn, when in this case the t of the derivative of the function, let's just write it like this, let's do it for partial derivative, dig, this is the integral over Rn, di g of x times f of x dnx, and then we can integrate by parts, which gives Rn g of x times minus di f of x dnx, and this is then the same as tg of minus dif. And now we use this identity in order to generalize the notion of derivative, namely we define, say, d alpha t acting on f by t acting on minus 1 to the order of alpha times d alpha f. And this is well defined because this derivative here is again a Schwarz function. This is it. In this way we can form derivatives of distributions. Of course, now one should do many examples and so on, but I don't want to do this here. Instead, I want to move on to the Fourier transform. And the method is to begin with Schwarz functions, and then we define the Fourier transform of a Schwarz function And I use this notation, though, x for position space, p for momentum space, and I also use my usual sign conventions. Of course, there are different possibilities for doing this here. So the way I do it is that for the Fourier transform, I take e to the I px dnx, and the Fourier back transform is defined by f hat of p times e to, then here's to be a minus sign, minus I to the I, e to the minus ipx times dnp, and then here I put the factor 2 pi to the n. So these are the conventions which I usually use. Let me state a few properties of the Fourier transform and its back transform. First of all, they are mappings from the Schwarz space to itself. It is obviously linear and it's also continuous. And moreover, the Fourier back transform really is the inverse of the Fourier transform. This means that f to the minus 1 composed with f is the same as f composed with f to the minus 1, is the identity on the Schwarz space. Okay, I don't want to prove this here. This is not really difficult. It follows from a rather direct computation. But I don't have time to go into this here, but you see it, of course, in the textbooks on our website. Okay, how can one define the Fourier transform of a distribution? And to this end, let's again consider a nice distribution, which is a function, and say a Schwarz function. Let G be Schwarz function. Okay, and then we can take T, for example, F G, so we consider its Fourier transform as a distribution, and then we apply this to F. So what is this? So let's first of all write F G. So this is the integral over Rn g of x times e to the I p x dnx. Okay, now this is a function of the variable p, and now we multiply this by f of p and integrate over p. Good, now here, since all the functions have rapid decay, we can exchange the two integral, so this means we write the integral over dnx first, and then we have here g of x times the integral, and here we have f of p times e to the I px dn P. And then one sees, okay, this is nothing but, well, what we have here is the Fourier transform of the function little f. So this is the same as so therefore we can write this as Tg of the Fourier transform of f. Okay, and now we can use the last identity again as the definition for whatever, what the operation on the distributions is. Namely, so it's again this dualization trick, so that we say the Fourier transform of a temper distribution is defined by T acting on F times F. So this is the Fourier transform of the distribution. And then it follows rather directly that f to the minus 1 is again the inverse Fourier transform, even for the, on this, for this extension to distributions. Of course, I should have said of tempered distributions. Okay, this is, these are the basic definitions. This is all there is, at least from the abstract point of view, of course. Now, when it comes down to how do you compute the Fourier transform of a distribution, this might be a bit tricky, but this is something we'll do later in detail when we need it. So therefore, I wanted to conclude here with a few remarks. First of all, the Fourier transform has another nice property, namely that it preserves the L2 norm. If we take F and G in L2 of Rn, well, then we can view them also as distributions, and therefore their Fourier transform is well defined. And then the F and F to the minus 1 turn out to be again in L2, and the L2 norm is in fact preserved. So this means, let's write it like this. So FF, FG, L2 norm in Rn is the same as FG, L2 norm on Rn. Well, and here one has to be careful with some factors of 2 pi, which again depend on our convention. Let's see, I guess like the way I do it, I have to multiply here by 1 over 2 pi to the n. But let's put a question mark. I'm not quite sure whether this prefactor is correct. Also, it doesn't really matter here. I mean, the point is that up to a constant, the Fourier transform preserves the L2 norm. And this is what is called Poincaré's theorem. Good, so this is the first remark. This is also quite useful also in quantum mechanics, because you can also compute whatever the probability integral in momentum space. Another remark is that there's also the notion of distributions, not tempered distributions, and this works as follows. So one considers compactly supported test functions with norms, but now, but well, there's no point in multiplying by a polynomial and taking the supremum, because this is compactly supported anyhow. So therefore one considers simply the norm of P, which is then the supremum or the maximum over all multi-indices of order at most P, and then the supremum of d alpha f over Rn. So one just has like this family of norms. Then one defines convergence again as above. So sequence converges if there's convergence with respect to all of these norms. Well, and then one introduces d of Rn as the dual. So as the continuous linear functionals with respect to the topology on C infinity 0, which we just chose. And this is the space of distributions. And this, well, in fact, we don't need it very often, but it is useful if we have functions which grow at infinity say, faster than polynomially, then such functions are not temper distributions, but they are distributions. So this means the good thing here is that this definition does not involve any growth conditions near infinity, so therefore this is a more general concept which we will use a few times in this course. Good, so let me stop here. I hope you liked this video and see you again soon. Bye-bye.